So thank you again for joining today. And I was thinking today we could discuss on the topic of the search for identity and how the search for identity is shaped by various contemporary ideologies. Say, we all have a particular, say, identity in terms of our name, our nationality. But beyond that, our conception of ourselves is shaped by the world ideologies like communism, capitalism. And often these subconsciously obstruct us when we try to develop our spiritual identity also. So I thought of, we'll look at two contemporary prominent worldviews in dark times are communism and capitalism. Of course, there is what is called a liberalism, but liberalism is more or less within within the capitalist setting itself.
Have you come across a definition of liberalism anywhere?
Have you come across a protagonist of liberalism, or it is just that we just don't want the bad things of both communism and capitalism? It is like that.
Liberalism, I studied it quite a bit. At one level, it portrays that liberalism means you can have whatever, you can practice whatever you want. So in that sense, the idea is if you are liberal, then different people of different faiths can practice whatever they want. So that is operational. But liberalism is also ideological, and the ideological level, it's very close to postmodernism, where there is no ultimate truth. And because there is no ultimate truth, therefore everybody can have their own truths. So postmodernism popularizes the idea of truth with a uppercase T and a truth with a lowercase T. And liberalism also uses that. So my truth is different from your truth, and both truths should be respected.
Okay.
So now, in your understanding, how would an ideology shape a person's self-conception or an identity? Or maybe you could talk a little bit about the ideology, or you could talk about the ideologies themselves, and then we can introduce capitalism and communism.
Yeah.
And then we can go to identities.
I'm more attracted towards that, being a student of economics in my college days. And I would really, really thank Srila Prabhupada for giving so much of a depth to what capitalism is, what are its good sides, what socialism or communism is, what may be their good sides, and what we have today. So just to very briefly, take a jog through history.
Sorry, you don't have to hold it throughout your talk. Can you just leave it and see how it comes? Can you speak?
It may suffer a little bit.
Yeah, it's very clear.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yes. It's okay. No problem. So, the kind of reference I have begins with, the Black Death, which roughly wiped out roughly 40 to 60% of Europe's population. There is a massive collapse in the old feudal order. So feudal order can be compared a little bit to India's zamindari system. Zameen is bhumi, land, dar means the owner. And those who stay there, they are taken care of. Well, that's a euphemism for exploited, not really taken care of, but everything is in the hands of the lord. So the Industrial Revolution, where giant smokestacks came up all over England, and the farm people were funneled into city life, and slowly the money power in their hands grew so much that first it was just the merchants, they became entrepreneurs, they became factory owners, and later they were termed as capitalists. So free market, these merchants, these traders, they actually paved the way for three things which people, they love to hate, if I can put it like that. And that is colonialism, slavery, and imperialism. it all came from wealth being concentrated in the hands of few. For example, you and me, we are kind of in India, or our destiny is bound to Indian history, little bit at least. So from the hands of these capitalists, it went to the British crown. But what happened was, whom did she appoint as the governor generals, and who were the real rulers here? The East India Company was abolished, but those big bosses of the East India Company just became lords and dukes and became part of the British Parliament. So this is what has been, and then they had the first thinker of, worth his salt, could be Adam Smith, who wrote the treatise Wealth of Nations. And that's the seminal book as to how people create wealth. So this gave rise to the idea of a free market. Prices are just dictated by the corporation. Production is also dictated by the corporation. And they said it's good because hard work is rewarded. And the more your company makes, the more you make. And one of the biggest things which people find it hard to adjust is that capitalism gives economic freedom, and economic freedom is linked with political freedom. Now, this is just a basic introduction to what capitalism is, that no government interference. Perhaps you have heard the French term called laissez-faire.
Yes.
Laissez-faire means free hand. I don't interfere with whatever you want to do. I'll just give a simple example. Let's say it's Mumbai and Pune, and there are people who want to go all the time from Mumbai to Pune, or Pune to Mumbai, vice versa. How many modes of transportation should be allowed? In capitalism, it's like as many as people want, no problem. So there could be an air-conditioned bus, there could be a rickshaw, there could be a bullock car, there could be a train, a bullet train, AC train, there could be a flight of only 25-30 minutes. In capitalism, they say we don't care how much fuel is being used. As long as there is someone to pay, we will do it. So basically, this is how capitalism is doomed, that you have such cutthroat competition. You have some buses going practically empty, just one or two people, and somebody traveling in super luxury while masses are huddled in some kind of a rickety old bus. The reaction to that is, why can't somebody be sensible and ration the amount of fuel used? So why not the government keep some sensible people, and they say how many people are needed, how many people should go from, they need to go from this city to, from Mumbai to Pune. So 400, all right. So we have 10 buses, 40 capacity, the fuel is controlled by the government, the fare is controlled by the government, and it makes sense, doesn't it? That so many people who otherwise could be competing and so much fuel could be utilized or whatever. They say, like if four companies are plying their buses and each is taking only 4, 10, 5, 6 people, but they're all paying for as much as the bus company needs. So they are saying, well, we are happy. But you could be carrying 80% more people, but you are sacrificing precious natural resources. So the biggest fault of capitalism is it doesn't care how much fuel we are using or how scarce or whatever, and what is the quality of human life. So the immediate, this is the one end of the pendulum. The other end of the pendulum is government controls everything. So this is the socialism or whatever, communism, which like I told you recently, socialism is the basic level. And when it becomes really high turbo kind of thing, it is communism. But there you have, there are 10 buses, 4 of them are not repaired. So they are not being utilized and nobody cares. So because like Prabhupada, I remember this saying by Prabhupada, you give somebody responsibility, sand becomes gold. You take away somebody's responsibility and gold can become sand. So in a sense, both capitalism and communism, they touch some part of the human psyche. I want to work. I want to be responsible. I want to enjoy the fruits of my hard work. And in communism, I also don't want to be part of a system which is giving so much of inequality or giving rise to so much of exploitation. So I just, according to my two cents, this is a summary of like a whole, I mean, we are taking a big bird's eye view of say 350 years of human history.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you. So I was thinking of if we want to put it very succinctly in terms of capitalism could be that it focuses on opportunity. You have the opportunity, you have the ability to succeed. But if you, on the other hand, in communism, the focus is on equality. That, in one sense, it's not just equality of opportunity, but equality of results. You might work very hard, and there is a classic explanation. So on one side, capitalism will cause exploitation, inequality, and indiscriminate, as you said, indiscriminate exploitation of resources as well as human beings. So on the other hand, if we have communism, then the human initiative is throttled. The classic example I heard was that this might be apocryphal or it might be real. If there's a classroom and in which the teacher tells that this is an exam and whatever is the top score, whatever is the bottom score, it will be averaged and everybody will get the average marks. So then the result of that is that students who could get the top I just lost you for a minute.
I also, yeah.
Let's hope that it works. Interestingly, the recording is going on, so the meeting also should be going on, it seems. Okay. So then what happens is that in this case, the top students feel, why should I study? I'm not going to get anything better by this. And the bottom students think, why should I study? Because anyway, I'm going to get good marks because of that. So, so it said that in capitalism, people are unequal, and they are, some people are wealthy, some people are poor. In communism, what ends up happening is people are equal and poor.
Yeah.
Because nobody is inspired to generate wealth. So there is, beyond this idea of inequality, or we could say opportunity, and equality, what underlies or what is neglected by most of ideologists is what is called a human nature. Human nature is that if we create a situation where everybody is equal, let's say people will all be happy. But human nature is such that we are competitive. We have ambitions and we want to say stand out in the herd, stand out above the group. So human nature is not entirely moldable according to any ideology. On the other hand, if in capitalism we say that, okay, some people have more talent, let them earn more money, let them share it with others. So charity may also not be innate to human nature. So we could say on one side, communism might activate the human tendency for lethargy, and capitalism can activate the human tendency for greed. So the basic problem, which neither of these ideologies really address, is that human nature is what it is. And this is where we can turn toward what is human nature? Ultimately, it's the soul covered by conditionings. And unless those conditionings are addressed, so both of these ideologies focus on creating a better society by adjusting things at the material level. And they need to be addressed at the material level, no doubt. But what about the inner level by which the material resources will be used or not used? So this is where, so this is my perspective of the what is overlooked in both ideologies is the foundational that human nature is not entirely pliable to any ideology.
Okay, just to take your point further about equality, if building the Ram Setu, I'm going into the Ramayana, building the Ram Setu is a project like Ram Lakshman Brothers Incorporated, and they are building a huge long bridge, 100 yojanas long, 800 miles long, and they have employees, and all the employees are Vanar Sena. So if it is capitalism, then the leader gets the prize and some of the top bigwigs, they get some share, while the ordinary Vanara just gets just a daily wage, something to fill his belly. And if it says communism, then communism means everybody gets some property in Lanka, and Sita becomes everybody's property. Now, I'm taking it to absurd lens just to show that how everybody has to be artificially made equal. It is not possible. And everybody knows it is Hanuman who jumped. Everybody else did not jump. They didn't have the capacity. So how do you, like in Russia, it was a real thing. How do you decide the wages for a university professor and for a farm laborer? And they could never figure it out, because people, I would like, if it is bread that is to be shared, then it's okay. But if I bring a cake, why should I share my cake? So from next year onwards, I also start bringing bread, because everybody is bringing bread, which is easy to share. So what Lord Ram did is, when he saw Hanuman breaking off a peak, a big, huge mountain peak, he rewarded him. He said, wow, wonderful work done. And then there is a squirrel. Some say squirrel, some say spider. What have you heard? Whether it's a squirrel or a spider?
Squirrel, I heard, yeah.
Okay, I heard both. So the squirrel is just putting some small grains into the ocean. Now the grain certainly is not the bridge. And that does, I mean, not certainly not, but how can that help carry so many millions and millions of vanaras? But what is Lord Ram's reply? That for me, both of you are valuable. So in capitalism as well as communism, in order to make, we are talking about identity. Identity depends upon so many factors, especially the main factors are self-esteem, how I am valued as a unit. Do I have any value? Do I make any difference? I see this in one letter Srila Prabhupada wrote to his disciples, that all those who are distributing books, if a small book gives a margin of 5 cents, it can help me buy a brick for Lord Chaitanya's temple in Mayapur. Genius. Even somebody has given one small book and the margin for the BBT is only 5 cents, that devotee is going to sleep tonight thinking that I'm contributing towards a big effort. So Lord Ram could do that. Every Vanara just had to write the word Ram on a rock, and seeing it float give them so much of self-esteem, so much of fulfillment of work. What capitalism is doing today is, like one person said in one comment, that it sucks you in, chews you, and spits you out. So many people today, now this is some latest poll, CNN as well as salon.com, that many youngsters in America, they're not saving money. They're not 60% or more don't have any savings. Why? It is capitalism. It gives you, it affords you a lot of opportunities, gives you a lot of opportunities to make money. they are feeling that by the time they are 60, that these are people who are 30, 35 today, by the time they are 60, there won't be any capitalism left. It'll all be greed. What we have is a ultra form of exploitation where 1% of the richest, they have more than 80% of the wealth. So it is not just the wealth which is being concentrated, it is the identity which is being trampled. So interestingly, I'll end with this. Karl Marx said, capitalism makes a person automaton. He's just a Mr. Nobody. He doesn't have any value. Surprisingly, this is the same criticism levied upon communist model, that it makes you simply an automaton. You don't think, you're like sheep. So both of them, these conflicting ideologies, have successfully made people into what someone in a very funny but derogatory way called sheeple. Have you heard this?
Yes.
So how does one prevent sheeple oneself?
Sheeple is a portmanteau, isn't it?
Sheep and people.
People, okay. Sheep like people, okay. Sheeple. Yeah.
That means you can't think for yourself. The system has successfully sucked out your gray cells. You can't think for yourself. So your identity is lost. And once you lose your identity, why do you care about others then?
Basically, we could say both, because they're foundationally materialistic, both ideologies reduce the living being to a producing and consuming machine. And the key difference is, in capitalism, you can produce and consume according to your capacity. Whereas in communism, it will be mandated how much you can produce. You will be told how much you have to produce, and you will be given how much you can consume. So one way of looking at this is that the locus of power or authority or decision making in communism comes with, in capitalism comes with the individual. In communism, it comes with the state. So Friedrich Nietzsche, he's known famously or infamously for his declaration, God is dead. However, when he declared God is dead, it was not in a celebratory mood. He was actually profoundly gloomy about the prospects of humanity after the death of God. Now, when he said that God is dead, what he meant was that at least he thought that the scientific and rational developments had made belief in God untenable. So in that sense,
actually, I read the whole thing. The whole statement is, and we have killed him. Something like that.
We have killed him. Oh,
so you're right. It is more in despair. Correct. That's the proper emotion which he wanted to convey.
He said that, you know, this is the greatest of sins, and the blood that has stained our hands, all the oceans of the world will not be enough to clean us of that stain.
Whoa.
So the point he said thereafter is that once we reject God, what will happen? Either we will have narcissism or we will have totalitarianism, which is quite profound. So we remove God as the center, then either I become the center or the state becomes the center. So in some ways, although communism says it's people who are at the center, but as George Orwell said, in communism, all people are equal, but some are more equal than others. So there are, if we see Stalin or Lenin or Mao Zedong, they were extremely powerful and ruthless dictators. So power did get concentrated in the hands of some people. So basically, either the individual becomes God, that means I decide what I want to do, and that's all. I am the sole authority for deciding what my life should be. Whereas the state becomes God, where the state decides this is what is good for you, this is what you should do, and that's the end of it. So we could say that at one level, now I'm taking it from what is the effect of these two ideologies on people's, as you said, self-esteem. So one thing I said is that it just reduces them to producing and consuming machines. But with apart from that, it places the they place the locus of responsibility at one level is only on the individual, and sometimes the individual can be crushed by that. Somebody is grown in poverty. You may say that education system is equal, but sometimes to get into the education system, you have to pay so much, you have to attend tuition classes. And is it really equal? Can a student maybe from the Midwest in America get into an Ivy League at all? So sometimes if you place the responsibility entirely on the individual, then the individual can get crushed. Some people might rise above their situations and attain meaningful, successful life, but it's difficult. But on the other hand, if you place the responsibility only on the state, then the state is also some individual. And what is, even if that individual is noble, is good, as we say, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Even if that individual leader is good, there will be others who are power hungry who will eliminate that individual, and they will assume power and they will abuse that power. So is the individual the sole decider or the state is the sole decider? Both of them neglect the idea that there is a God and we are parts of God. So in some ways, communism was explicitly anti-God, explicitly atheistic. Not just atheistic, but say anti-theistic. There was a persecution of religious people of those devoted to God in Russia, in China. Now, capitalism may not be...
You know, they preferred the word nihilistic. That means
nihilistic.
Yeah, not needed. It could be there, but not needed. It's like a spare part for a product which you don't need that spare part at all now. That is more abusive in one sense. It's like a,
So when Karl Marx said that religion is the opium of the masses, I realized that what he said by the word opium, there are three distinct connotations of it.
Okay.
It's like, one is when you take opium, then you get into an intoxicated state and you imagine that you are happy, when you're actually not happy.
Yeah.
So he says that religion makes you believe that, oh, there is a good God overseeing the world. And that makes you feel a sense of peace. But religion doesn't give you peace necessarily immediately. Religion gives you peace by promising that there is some other world where you will be rewarded if you live according to religious authorities. But the result of this is just like when a person takes opium, that person just becomes deadened practically, becomes inactive. So communism focuses a lot on social activism, social transformation. In fact, social engineering is central to communism. So the idea is that if you take the opium of religion, you will become paralyzed and you will not be socially active. And thus his thought was that religion is simply a tool in the hands of the wealthy and the powerful to keep the masses inactive. And in fact, there was one European thinker, I think Diderot or somebody, he said that humanity will not know peace till the throat of the last king is choked with the intestines of the last priest.
My God.
So their idea was that with this whole religion structure is meant to keep people passive. So we could say king is like the Kshatriya and the priest is like the Brahmana. So just destroy that whole structure. So it was explicitly anti-religious. Capitalism, it is functionally materialistic. It is not necessarily anti-religious in terms of ideology, but it is functionally, because the whole focus is on gaining material things, So then God goes into the background. In some ways, in America, the Protestant, within Protestantism, there was the ideology of prosperity theology, that if we are prosperous, that itself indicates that we are pious and God has blessed us. And what you talked about colonialism and imperialism, that was also a belief driving them, that because we are blessed by God, that's why we are so powerful, we are so wealthy. So communism doesn't so much co-opt God into its social engineering project. It just rejects God. But capitalism often co-opts God, that those who are wealthy and powerful, they are blessed by God. Any thoughts about this or any?
Yeah, when you mentioned about how the last king should be choked with the priest's entrails, I would just like to shed a small kind of a light on how a reader of Srimad Bhagavatam, understanding Maharaj Parikshit's history from that time onwards till today, can we make a sense of it? So we have the intellectuals, Brahmas, we have the administrators, the Kshatriyas, we have the mercantilists, the Vaishyas, and we have the tertiary sector, those who serve them, and then those who are below them, who may not be even part of the main culture of a particular country. They could be living either in forest areas or even hilly areas or even beyond that. So Srimad Bhagavatam begins with some big problem at the head. There is a saying that a fish rots from the head.
Yes.
So when there is a arrogance and power in the hands of the intellectuals, and especially immaturity, if I read the purports of the first canto dealing with cursing of Maharaj Parikshit, it is the immaturity of Sringi which is highlighted. And therefore, when Brahmanas start acting irresponsibly, then people don't care about them. So the kings start acting irresponsibly. And that's where you see last 3,500 years, that Rome gave one of the worst examples of the excesses committed by kings, right up to England when they signed the Magna Carta, where although you are a king, you are supposed to be under some kind of a committee or whatever, so that your powers need to be restricted. So up to Napoleon and then so many sundry kings. And so the first order lost its power. The second order lost its power. The third order surreptitiously is keeping its power. And the October Revolution in Russia just afforded the fourth order that, okay, because you operate the machine, you decide the production and you decide the price also. But that is wholly unnatural. The fourth order is simply useless without being guided by and protected by the upper three. So that's why today we have no first order, no second order, no proper fourth order. We just have the third order, merchants, mercantilists, and they are also under threat because they know they are in minority. So, as I say, for some time, the people can see the 1% living, wallowing in the life of luxury. And after some time, if they can't take it, they just rebel and they may just kill all of them. So, Ishavasyamidam Sarvam, only when the top order intellectuals, if they propagate and prove, propagate is one thing. To tell somebody, share your wealth is one thing. Like the Bhudan movement in India was started by Vinoba Bhave, and he was respected as a saint, and he would go to rich people and say that, don't you see the dire straits in which the poor are living? Why can't you give something voluntarily? They gave. According to one reading, it's about 500,000 acres of land was given voluntarily. Totally barren. So,
totally
just like,
barren.
Yeah. So okay. Once Akbar told Birbal that, you know, since I'm such a good monarch, I think majority of my capitalist population is scrupulously honest. And Birbal just gave a wry smile. Hey, come on, Birbal, what do you mean? He said, okay. Birbal arranges for a command to be given to every inhabitant of Delhi. This Monday, come with a pot or a lota of milk from your own household. And people started grumbling. Why this king gets all these idiotic ideas? Now he wants milk from us. So the idea was that you have to bring milk, stand in a line, go to the underground tank in the royal courtyard, deposit that milk and go away. And there was no checking or whatever. So the next morning, thousands were lined up. And Akbar all smiles telling Birbal that, I told you, because I'm good, people are honest. So the last man left, both of them went down. And Birbal was smiling and Akbar was shocked. The tank was still showing only water. So he said, Birbal, how did this happen? He said, well, everybody thought since everybody else is going to bring milk, why should I waste my milk?
Okay.
So the identity of an individual according to communism is unless you threaten him, he won't work. And the identity of a capitalist is unless you show him a big carrot, he won't work. So capitalism promises riches in the vast desert of materialistic consumerism. And communism gives you a whack on your backside if you don't work. And people are just fed up to their buck teeth with this kind of thing. And Bhagavatam's ancient model of trained people who are leaders, thought leaders, but they know what is individual identity, how to respect even the 10th order of the society, and they are selfless. So because they are selfless, they can guide kings. And if kings are guided, they can protect and discipline the mercantilists. And then they can, in a measured way, they can take care of the 4th order. So that is one solution which can come from our...
Yeah, okay. I just lost you in the last part a little bit. But I got the gist. You said that this is a solution from our Bhagavatam's tradition's perspective.
Yes. Isn't it? The Vedic wisdom...
There's a lot of territory you covered and what points you made.
Yeah.
Let's start with the initial thing. Ravindra Swarup Prabhu has written an essay where he talks about how he explains European history in terms of the decline of the Varanas, what you said basically. But the way he puts it is that the Reformation was basically a rebellion of the Kshatriyas against the Brahmanas. Because Martin Luther and others, they were funded and supported by the German monarch and others. So the Kshatriyas were, the kings wanted to free themselves from the authority of the Pope. The Pope who had become like a super king. So the Kshatriyas rebelled against the Brahmanas. And then talks about the French Revolution, which was 1789. That was a rebellion of the Vaishyas against the Kshatriyas. Now, although there is a masses who stormed into the palace of Fort Louis and the queen, and was it Queen Antoinette? The queen who said that if you don't have bread, you can take cakes.
Marie Antoinette, yeah.
Yeah, Queen Mary. So then that was, but they were all supported or powered by the business people who wanted to reject the authority of the kings because they felt this, we are creators of wealth, these kings are doing nothing but enjoying luxuries. And eventually, the Bolshevik Revolution was basically a rejection of the Vaishyas by the Shudras. So that was the Russian Revolution 1917. Now, of course, whenever we whenever we try to interpret historical events, there could always be different interpretations, but that's an interesting way of looking at it. So overall, there is we could consider that there is communism, there is capitalism, and then there is the Vedic system of Varnashram. So communism says that people are equal, capitalism says that people are unequal. So let everybody according to their opportunity, everybody succeed according to their opportunity, or rather everybody succeed according to their ability, whatever they have. But communism says that everybody get the equal results. So one way this could be integrated, and we can't really uncritically endorse, because in India also we had the exploitative discriminatory caste system coming up. But my understanding is that the fundamental problem is, if we think any ideology will solve the problems of society, that itself is a mistake, because first of all we need to understand human nature and see how human nature can be addressed. So whether we had the caste system in India, whether we have capitalism, or whether we have communism, whatever it is, unless human nature is addressed, we will not be able to, no system will work. So even in the Indian setting, the Brahmanas abused their power, the Kshatriyas abused their power, and eventually it became an extremely discriminatory system. So Varnashram became the caste system. So if we consider the human nature as foundational, human nature is what needs to be addressed. So if we can't address human nature, then whatever ideology we create, it will not help. And human nature can be best reformed or refined by spirituality. So if we consider the Gita, the Gita of Bo has both a spirituality as an individual practice and spirituality as a social social arrangement. So much of the Bhagavad Gita's practice of yoga that is recommended is, say, somebody practices individually. But along with that, Krishna is also telling Arjuna, you have a social responsibility. You have to become a spiritual head of state. You become spiritually aware, spiritually conscious head of state. And then you have to, then you can also create systems in society by which overall human nature can be reformed. So as of now, in the world that we have today, most of the world is free market, with some amount of governmental regulation. The amount can vary from place to place. So China is, even Russia is not communist. China is also, you can't call it communist. It is capitalist in economy and maybe somewhat like communist in ideology, in politics. So political hold is very strong, but at the same time, it has adopted some of the principles of free market. Not entirely. So whether we could ever go back to the system of Varnashram, that is open to question. But what could be done is, we could look at how Varnashram, that system, was meant to address the limitations and the potentials and the pitfalls of human nature. And we can see how that can be done today, in today's world. But unless we have a spiritual sense of our life, of our identity and our purpose, there is something beyond matter to be achieved. If material things are only what I'm going to achieve, then communism is only going to give me this much. Why should I work more? If material things are only what I'm going to achieve, then capitalism says, you work hard, you get more. Okay, I'll get more. If I can get, why should I think of anything else? If I can't get, then the system is exploitative. So unless there is an understanding that we human beings are meant for something more than material need. Material welfare is of course important, and that has to be taken care of. But unless there is an understanding that we need something more, that human beings are meant for something more than, say, earning a paycheck or getting the less latest Silicon Valley gadget or such things, without some facility for people to experience non-material enrichment, human nature will cause any ideology to collapse, whether it is capitalism, whether it is communism, or whether it is what has become the caste system now. So any thoughts on this?
Yeah, very true. So I was just thinking that let's say there is 10,000 acres of some big capitalist iron ore producing corporation. So the guy who is at the top feels that this is my land. The government changes, it becomes communist. Now the government says it is our land. The fundamental thing which needs to be change in order to affect human nature is that Sarvaloka Maheshwaram, there is actually one owner of this land, and we need to acknowledge his not presence, not benevolence, but ownership. So understanding that God is love, God loves you, God wants you to celebrate or whatever, with regards to identity, the first thing should be God is the proprietor, he is the owner, and therefore logically he is the enjoyer. Now whether that enjoyer God allows you to participate in his enjoyment or not, that can be sorted out later. Thankfully, Krishna is not that kind of a selfish or a jealous or exploitative God who feels that if you're not my devotee, then I can just obliterate you. I can just finish off your identity. No, the identity is very much kept alive. And accepting Krishna's ownership, accepting Krishna as the three things which 5.29 Bhagavad Gita emphasizes: original owner, original proprietor, controller, and therefore the original enjoyer. So our identity is, and it is best served when we become the secondary enjoyers. So enjoyment is not prohibited. Your fulfillment of life is not prohibited. Entertainment is not prohibited. So without this pivotal central understanding, capitalism promises you all kinds of gory enjoyment like the Roman gladiatorial conquests and deaths and arena and amphitheater enjoyment, and the so-called communist Russia's totally sterilized, just the proletariat workers singing happy songs or factory workers singing happy songs. In fact, they were so obsessed with the idea that there were actually 4 or 5 candidates who could go to space. But because Yuri Gagarin's father was a farmer, they chose him. So that we could show the world that even a farmer's son can become the world's first spaceman. And to their anger, they realized that this doesn't solve the problem. With so many famines and so many droughts, and so much mismanagement of crops. Like in capitalism, the mismanagement is too much of production and grains are thrown in the ocean just to keep the prices stable. So this is what makes people's blood boil. That nature is giving you, Krishna is giving you through nature, but you're throwing it away. And then totally nihilistic attitude towards life, and you're not even getting your bread. So it's not, so these two polar things, and they are, both of them are still active in life today. Just see the damage they have done to one person trying to fulfill his identity. That can I live as a unit in this 7.5 billion population? Can I live as a unit who can find fulfillment? And at least I can say that Gita and Bhagavatam doesn't disappoint you.
That is true.
There is no utopia, as you rightly said. We cannot turn the clock back so much that we can have the full Varnashram kind of reigning supreme. But at least individually, collectively, we may not see that revolution happening. But at least individually, we can have the benefits of capitalism, where we can choose our vocation, and we may also have that kind of equal vision. The Gita stresses so much upon equal vision, not the outside one, but the inner one. And a society without that inner vision, things are completely chaotic.
Yes. So you're talking about the prices being kept low artificially by stocks being thrown. Same thing happened in communism also. In China, there was a great leap forward under Mao Zedong. And they decided that we would centralize, all the crops will come to a central place and then they will be redistributed according to need. And every unit started bloating, you know, we have got this much crops, we have got this much crops, we have got this much grains. And the grains were in the granary and people outside were starving, but they were not given access to the grains. Because the idea is these grains have to go to the central and allot it back. And everybody was inflating their count, and eventually it was one of the worst famines in human history. So this human tendency for the in one sense, we could say capitalism, less human nature play its role within the competition of other human people, other people playing their roles. No, I have my greed, but others also have their greed. So we will compete and let's see who succeeds. But in communism, if one person grabs the authority, then if that person is greedy or power hungry or exploitative, it can cause terrible damage. So no, maybe we'll need another session to discuss that the idea of spirituality, say that I am at my core a spiritual being, or that God is to be accepted as the authority. As you said, God is the proprietor of everything. How would that be translatable into today's world? Because at one level, spirituality is considered to be a matter of private practice today. If you want to believe, you believe. If you want to practice something, that's up to you. It doesn't gel so well with the state, and the idea is that we have a secular world today, secular world order, more or less. Most countries are secular, except in the Middle East. So then, within such a society, because we're also a multicultural world, how would we have the principle of God being the center? So at an individual level, we can have people becoming more spiritually conscious. But is something practical at the spiritual, at the social level? Maybe we could continue the discussion next time.
Sure. What do you feel? Yeah. Why not?
Summarize.
Because I think we covered a lot of territory in diverse ways. So we started by discussing first what the basic ideologies of capitalism and communism are. Capitalism is that I do my, that if I have the ability, then I will gain the wealth, and sometimes people can become terribly wealthy and they can be terribly exploitative. On the other hand, in communism, the government mandates equality, but then people's initiative is lost. So from a spiritual perspective, we could say that both are materialistic, because both treat people as producing and consuming machines. And from a theistic or a devotional perspective, when God is rejected, either communism makes the individual into God, so we have narcissism, or we have totalitarianism, where the state or the head of state becomes God. And traditionally we had Varnashram, which in India, which in principle was supposed to give people opportunity according to their abilities, while keeping a keeping a spiritual structure because of the spiritual brahmanas who were at the head of the social body. But here also we see that there was a degeneration to the discriminated caste system. So the basic problem would be that human nature is vulnerable to greed or lethargy or other such weaknesses, and unless that is addressed, no ideology will work. So the Bhagavad Gita gives us spiritual principles that can help us address to channel the potentials of human nature and to counter the pitfalls of human nature. Were there any other points as such?
No, briefly you covered almost everything. So we'll take it forward.
So in the next session we'll discuss about how spirituality can be incorporated within the today's social systems. Thank you very much for your stimulating discussion.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.